The war is the first and only thing in the world today. The arts generally are not. Nor is this writing a diversion from that, for relief, a turning away. It is the war, or part of it, merely a different sector of the field.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Stefania Heim. I am one of the poetry editors at Boston Review. And I'm particularly excited to welcome you all tonight for this reading, which I think joins a couple of elements that feel particularly urgent right now, being the necessity and potential of language as a powerful weapon that bridges the intimate and the social and the public and the political, and the joining together of voices in solidarity and music. And we have an extraordinary panel of poets who are going to do those things. I'm just going to read out their names. You can see them also on stage, and they're going to read in the order in which they're seated. They are Lucie Brock-Broido, Jorie Graham, Major Jackson, Ricardo Maldonado, Nathan Xavier Orsorio, Monica Youn, and Peter Gizzi.
Hi, I'm B.K. Fisher. This slim book found its spark in a singular moment, a moment in November when we found ourselves reeling, in need of the discernment and reverberation that poetry can provide. But the poems gathered here and their languages of engagement and resistance have been fired in the crucibles of shared histories for a long time, fired in the heat of struggle, witness, subversion, and song. In time of crisis, we summon up our strength, wrote poet Muriel Rukeyser, who became for us a kind of patron saint as this collection came together at the turn of the year. We reached out to the visionaries among us, and the poets floored us. They sent poems still hot to the touch or wet with grief. They sent lament, interrogation, parody, pastiche, declamation, litany and lyric, outrage and cri de coeur. Our luminous poet laureate, Juan Felipe Herrera, took up the parcel we sent him and he told it like it is. Guess what, America? Everyone in this rough-cut, deep-hearted chapbook loves you as much as they have fought with you and for you. Everyone here wants an American home, an American national house in a global neighborhood without children who make bulletproof vests out of cardboard. I am getting carried away, America, right? I guess I am, because all of these poets have been at this all of their lives, writing for you, America, calling out for you, America, in cafes, bookstores, and community centers, women's shelters, prisons and juvenile halls, bilingual classrooms, islands, archipelagos, universities, LGBTQ readings, 9/11 memorials, addiction centers, women's clinics, senior centers, the recent massacres, America. Listen to me, the recent massacres. Writing, scribbling supersonic speed for you. Do you hear me? We do hear you with immense gratitude. We're honored to hear your voices rising from these pages and here in this room tonight. Rukeyser is our invocation. Always we need the audacity to speak for more freedom, more imagination, more poetry with all its meanings. Our first reader is Lucie Brock-Broido.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming. I think one good thing is that, if I'm right, that Democratic senators and congresspeople are gathering tonight at the Supreme Court. Is that so? If so, that's really a first. But another first is that Chuck Schumer went to who I call President-elect Trump yesterday and was weeping over the passage of this new act. And Trump said that Schumer wasn't Schumer was a manly man and he didn't cry, and that there was about a 5% possibility that his tears were real and that he had a really good acting coach. What a prick. In November, I'm just going to read one poem here, and in November of 2015, the Republican Senate passed a nasty bit of business called the American Security Against Foreign Enemies Act. It upped the ante on vetting and stalling the entrance of Syrian refugees into the United States. I wrote a poem about this legislation, a poem I thought would be durable. And that's the piece I'm going to read. As of this past Saturday morning, the act was dwarfed by Trump's executive order called Protecting the Nation from Foreign Terrorist Entry into the United States. We know all about this now, and we are appalled and ashamed. Charles Blow wrote this morning in the New York Times, Trump's America is brutal, perverse, regressive, insular, a vast expanse of darkness and desolation. He concluded, not in our name, not on our watch. Collecting data from the last 41 years, the chance of an American being murdered in an attack caused by a foreign refugee is 1 in 3.64 billion. The poem I'm going to read is based on the earlier act from November of 2015, in the days before there was such a thing as extreme vetting that there is now. So imagine a husband, a wife, and their small child. After having passed through the rigors of 2 years of vetting on their way from Syria to America, one last hoop to jump. A U.S. government official is the inquisitor here and asks the family a rash of questions that are rhetorical, arch, impossible, and maybe some are just simply unanswerable. The American Security Against Foreign Enemies Act. Why do you feel most vulnerable? Where in Damascus were you born? To whom do you pray? What does it mean to have winged brows? Have you ever spoken, ma'am, through a mesh? Was it dark speech that you made? Is it hot inside your burqa? Who was Frank Sinatra? Why was our war called civil, and who won? Can you keep a bright gaze? How tall was Allah? What once was Palestine? What most displaces you? Have you ever visited Somalia? Have you ever crossed a border in a boat at night to another land? Sir, in all, how many died? Is your wife considered meek? Point to Mecca from right here. Why is our court supreme? What does the sound and the fury mean to you? Who was Huckleberry Finn? Has your husband ever traveled to Afghanistan? In Sharia, when a woman's hair is loose, is she a prostitute or slave? Do you understand what red state means? Do you speak American? Here, read this aloud. Do you have tattoos? What does paranoia mean? In what season do we vote for president? How much freedom does the First Amendment cost? Which is the tallest tree? You were once a doctor. How is it, as you say, you've come to selling vegetables? How tall was Jesus in his bare feet? Do you consider him a refugee? Have you a disease that is contagious? What are the Hunger Games? Who sang Moon River best? Do you have friends or relatives who are barbarians. What is the blues? What is a second sleep? What most once made you weep? When was Lincoln? Who is Stephen King? Explain what obfuscation means. Have you ever been lashed? Who were our pilgrims? Why did they come? Have you ever eaten eel? Why do you bring just one small son? Where are the other ones? What are your other sons? Thank you.
Thank you for doing this. Thank you all for coming. I'm going to read one poem, which takes 6 minutes, so I'm not going to say much about it, except that it is by an Iraqi poet named Sadi Youssef, a man who would not have been let into the United States yesterday, or who knows when again. He lives in London, and he was born just outside of Basra. This poem has everything in it, and it explains itself, so I don't have to say much. But when I was coming over here, I said to my husband, I looked it up, Peter, we pretty much destroyed Basra, right? And he said, Jorie, we destroyed everything. So this is speaks for itself, and it beautifully follows the incredibly powerful poem Lucie just read. And really seems to have been written in part by Juan Felipe Herrera and his beautiful introduction to this incredible chapbook. It might look meager and small, but it's an extraordinary collection. America, America. God save America. My home, sweet home. The French general who raised his tricolor over Nukrat al-Salman, where I was a prisoner 30 years ago. In the middle of that U-turn, that split in the back of the Iraqi army, the general who loves Saint-Emilion wines called Nukrat al-Salman a fort. On the surface of the earth, generals know only two dimensions. Whatever rises is a fort. Whatever spreads is a battlefield. How ignorant the general was. But Liberation was better versed in topography. The Iraqi boy who conquered her front page sat carbonized behind a steering wheel on the Kuwait-Safwan highway, while television cameras, the booty of the defeated and their identity, were safe in a truck like a storefront on the Rue de Rivoli. The neutron bomb is highly intelligent. It distinguishes between an I and an identity. God save America. My home, sweet home. How long must I walk to Sacramento? How long must I walk to Sacramento? How long will I walk to reach my home? How long will I walk to reach my girl? How long must I walk to Sacramento? For 2 days, no boat has sailed this stream. 2 days, 2 days, 2 days. Honey, how can I ride? I know this stream, but, for 2 days, no boat has sailed this stream. La li la la li la. La li la la li la. A stranger becomes afraid. Have no fear, dear horse. No fear of the wolves of the wild. No fear, for the land is my land. La li la la li la. La li la la li la. A stranger becomes afraid. God save America. My home, sweet home. I too love jeans and jazz and Treasure Island and John Silver's parrot and the balconies of New Orleans. I love Mark Twain and the Mississippi steamboats and Abraham Lincoln's dogs. I love the fields of wheat and corn and the smell of Virginia tobacco, but I am not American. Is that enough for the Phantom Pilot to turn me back to the Stone Age? I need neither oil nor America herself, neither the elephant nor the donkey. Leave me, pilot, leave my house roofed with palm fronds and this wooden bridge. I need neither your golden gate nor your skyscrapers. I need the village, not New York. Where did you come to me from, your Nevada desert, soldier armed to the teeth? Why did you come all the way to distant Basra, where fish used to swim by our doorstep? Pigs do not forage here. I only have these water buffaloes lazily chewing on water lilies. Leave me alone, soldier. Leave me my floating cane hut and my fishing spear. Leave me my migrating birds and my green plumes. Take your roaring iron birds and your tomahawk missiles. I am not your foe. I am the one who wades up to the knees in rice paddies. Leave me to my curse. I do not need your day of doom. God save America, my home. Sweet home, America, let's exchange gifts. Take your smuggled cigarettes and give us potatoes. Take James Bond's golden pistol and give us Marilyn Monroe's giggle. Take the heroin syringe under the tree and give us vaccines. Take your blueprints for model penitentiaries and give us village homes. Take the books of your missionaries and give us paper for poems to defame you. Take what you do not have and give us what we have. Take the stripes of your flag and give us stars. Take the Afghani Mujahideen beard and give us Walt Whitman's beard filled with butterflies. Take Saddam Hussein and give us Abraham Lincoln or give us no one. Now as I look across the balcony, across the summer sky, the summery summer, Damascus spins, dizzied among television aerials. Then it sinks deeply in the stones of the forts, in towers, in the arabesques of ivory, and sinks deeply far from Rukn al-Din and disappears far from the balcony. And now I remember trees. The date palm of our mosque in Basra, at the end of Basra, a bird's beak, a child's secret, a summer feast. I remember the date palm. I touch it. I become it when it falls black without fronds, when a dam fell hewn by lightning. And I remember the mighty mulberry when it rumbled, butchered with an axe, to fill the stream with leaves and birds. And angels, and green blood. I remember when pomegranate blossoms covered the sidewalks, the students were leading the workers' parade. The trees died, pummeled, dizzied, not standing. The trees died. God save America. My home, sweet home. We are not hostages, America. And your soldiers are not God's soldiers. We are the poor ones. Ours is the earth of the drowned gods, the god of bulls, the god of fires, the gods of sorrows that intertwine clay and song in one blood. We are the poor. Ours is the god of the poor who emerges out of farmers' ribs, hungry and bright, and raises heads up high. America, we are the dead. Let your soldiers come. Whoever kills a man, let him resurrect him. We are the drowned ones, dear lady. We are the drowned. Let the water come.
Good evening. It's a pleasure to be among this chorus of voices exercising what is distinctly American, which is an art in the service of values that we cherish. And I'm really honored to be part of this anthology, from which I'm going to read the poem that's in here. I'm going to read two poems, one for our domestic policy and the other for our foreign policy. This is from Urban Renewal, and it was written after visiting a refugee camp in East Africa called Dadaab about 3 years ago. In the placid lean of an arid summer, in the lingering snarl of a pit latrine, in the sharp barbs of the acacia thorn tree, in the opaque eyes of the girl fingering frenziedly her arm's badge of skin suffering cholera, unearth a feeling for a people who are not your own. In the sinister look of the man beneath the kufi yad, he is not Al-Shabaab, and the boy selling refurbished phones in the market, wary of your presence, your queries, the aloof gaze of women behind hijabs who flee your camera's barrel, who swiftly turn and cover in this land devoid of vegetation like a dried sea that stretches to their war-torn country scarred over like a child soldier's back. The camp swell in singeing heat, hot as empty air of eyeless politicians who have no stake in other clans. Embrace the father who chews cot, the girl who sells her limbs for all her body can take. Think of the rootless, the dispersed, when you slide into the porcelain glove of your tub like an emperor, call back the horn of Africa. Close the divide for fear of despair's reprisal. Pray they love in return. Really delighted to read this poem in this room again. It was a year ago that I premiered this poem right here. Okay. This is called Ferguson. Once there was a boy who thought it a noble idea to lie down in the middle of the street and sleep. For 4 hours, no one bothered him, but let him lie on the road as though he were an enchantment. This became newsworthy, and soon helicopters hovered above, hosing his curled torso and thick legs, and spotlights televised the world over. Foreign correspondents focused on the neighborhood and its relative poverty as recognized by the plethora of low-hanging jeans worn by shirtless men and loud music issuing from passing cars, which had the effect of drowning out everyone's bottled-up thoughts about the boy sleeping in the middle of the street. Others jumped in front of cameras, seizing an opportunity to be seen by their relatives on the other side of town because they had run out of minutes on prepaid cell phones. The roadkill in the neighborhood and some on that very block, rodents, cats, and possums feeling equal amounts of jealousy and futility, each began to rise and return to their den holes, cursing the boy sleeping in the street beneath their breaths for his virtuosic performance of stillness and tribulation in the city. The drug-addicted men and women leaning into doorways like art installations were used to being ignored, but they too felt affronted by the boy sleeping in the street and folded their cardboard homes. For the first hour, he practiced not breathing. For 10 seconds, he would hold his breath, and then he practiced longer sets of minutes. During the next 3 hours, until he was able to stretch out his non-breathing for whole hunks at a time. When his breathing returned, it was so faint, his chest and shoulders barely moved. Infinitesimal amounts of life poured out of him, but no one noticed. The police cordoned off his body. and after some time declared him dead because they had only seen black men lying prone on the street as corpses, but never as sleeping humans. The whole world, eager and hungry for a Lazarus moment, watched and waited to see when he would awaken and rise to his feet, especially his neighbors, with minutes remaining on cell phones, who filmed and animatedly discoursed behind yellow tape the ecstasies and muted sorrows of watching a boy sleep in the middle of the street. Thank you.
Buenas noches. Mi nombre es Ricardo Maldonado. Hi, I'm Ricardo Maldonado. I'm from Puerto Rico. I will also read a poem entitled America, America. This one is mine. As a Puerto Rican, I've always been negotiating a continental identity. America is a continent, it's not a country, versus a very singular, assertive nation manifested, as it were. So I will start with this poem, and then I'll read one in Spanish, part of a project I'm working on, where I'm writing letters to McNamara, Nixon, Kennedy, all those involved in the Vietnam War. America, America. In interiors, by nightlight and by our own admission, we levitate. It is our birthright. Suppose the cargo was brought for our welfare, a kind of instruction toward ill, produce we could not afford, an attempt to recover the economy of youth, thoughts about the climate and the waste of our prose. There were trees that the storm had reserved, fathers unmannered at the effort. Our theater confused the gods. We observed the trees. We never knew the fluttering made them distinct. Los documentos de McNamara. Era el cáncer sobre su herida que buscábamos bajo las sábanas, su astronomía. Su cuerpo en su caracol de lodo sangraba sobre un imperio de hojas en oscuro dormitorio de julio. Vietnam, media luna de ayer. Tres venas de su niñez cegadas por el sol. Un país como trozo de piel sobre el cual escribíamos nosotros mismos. Su carne, su espíritu, como golondrina mecánica entre mis manos, un tintero bajo mi cama, su desierto de tabaco húmedo, una rosa en su pulmón. Mi padre, uno entre asesinos. Comprendí que su sangre era un río del cual bebíamos antes de ser niños, entre raíces tiernas y musgos. Recordé su fábula de selva entre hojas de vidrio. A mi madre en julio, que mi hermana duerme, que mi padre despertó como Judas con su Dios, el vientre extendido, mientras orinaba como animal. From McNamara's documents. It was cancer whose astronomy we searched under our bedsheets. This is my translation, and I'm still working on it. His body encased in mud, bled over an empire of leaves in July's darkening room. Vietnam, yesterday's half moon, three veins for his childhood singed by the sun, a country like a scrap of skin on which we would write ourselves, his flesh, his spirit like a metallic sparrow in my hands, an inkwell under my bed, a desert of wet tobacco, a rose in his lung. My father was one among assassins. I came to understand that his blood became a river from which we would drink before we were children among tender roots and moss. I remember his fable in a jungle of glass leaves, my mother in July, that my sister sleeps, that my father had awakened like Judas with his God, his stomach distended to relieve himself like an animal. Thank you.
I just want to begin by thanking all of the editors at Boston Review for putting together this very important and necessary anthology. And also to thank all of you, because what America may even need more than its poets are its open-minded and readers. So thank you for being here tonight. My first poem is called Querida America. Querida America, my lonely days are over. I ride the train upstate past the military academy to sit in gazebos in the woods and listen to the crickets pelt the headstones. From here, I can see the black body of the mountain and where it breaks into the stars. The belly of the dead doe churns with the passel of possums I bury beneath my breast. Querida America, I remember your promise and put my lips to the gas tank. I whisper a line from Benny and the Jets. We'll kill the fatted calf tonight, so stick around. And the crypt cracks open, giving birth to a fluorescent Union 76 ball. The moths gather and mold their cotton wings along its body. You were such a good girl, with your tiny feet like mango seeds. My mother fell in love with your curly red hair and the way you ate chocolate straight from the conveyor belt. When she got sick and fat, we found orange rinds and the smell of grass clippings. Querida America, the last train home has left. You hung my serrated baby teeth in the pines, fed me government cheese and cow tongue, asked me to listen to the obedient winding of the river mill. I dozed, and when I woke, you had sliced away my tattoo of Quetzalcoatl and tied the old possum's tail to paws, wearing them like a necklace to show me you were listening. Querida America, our lonely days are over. Our railroad has wilted. Our river rotted. Our moths are only statues. Our orange ball has flown away. Our teeth hang on the dead branches. Our crickets have turned the tinsel into nests. Our mother is still on the operating table. Our memory keeps her smelling fresh. And my last poem is the poem in the anthology and is about my drives I used to take with my father into Tijuana, Mexico. English as a second language. Surrendering to nausea in the felt-lined Tijuana-bound camper, I doubted the integrity of the breast-shaped nuclear reactors fixed on the Pacific shore, cherry pink nipples upright and beaconing at a waltz tempo to the deep water roughnecks swaying in their hemp hammocks below a network of oil lines spouting flames into the oceanic infinitude, dyed dead eagle god red, and I shrinking in importance, like in my collegiate days when I nodded submissively to a professor who assured me my failure was because English was my second language, which is true if second to the cosmic mutterings of black holes, which is true nights I bellow desert monsoons into extinction, which is true when my hands are held up bearing the Atlantean burden of brownness, but which is most true here, surrendering to nausea in the felt-lined Tijuana-bound camper, piloted by my dark-skinned father who I've only ever understood in dialect, amalgamated from epazote and McDonald's fries gathered between the San Gabriel Mountains and Popocatepec, who continues his delicate lament of ash, even when exposed by the melting glaciers that once kept his morning summit numb. I whisper to the ExxonMobil gas station that I too can love enough to become a volcano and reach out so that my palm skates atop a gust of sea breeze in the invisible exhaust of topless convertibles, blonde hair pouring upwards from the front seats and strangling the open air, uninhibited and drunken with the riches of the West, the tall straw rippling on the hillside in unison, the mega outlet with its 24-hour security desk illuminating the alleyways of the bad neighborhood, and the hordes of day laborers spilling out into the avenues, climbing atop trucks, unsolicited, sharp-eyed, and hungry. Now I will say it, blessed be the Virgin Mary, that I've kept this close to the southern frontier, this close to the police beat and the ticking tear gas canisters, this close to the unidentifiable pots of spices roiling in the night markets. I reach to Gloria Anzaldúa and read Borderlands, till I lose sight of the swallow's nest that stippled the cliffsides and drift onto the harbor freeway, where in March 2006 the children of the frontier were in multitudes, curdling traffic 1,000 strong as I sat sugar-buzzed and unobstructive in homeroom. And now my head rolls forward and I startle awake, the idled nuclear reactor pulsing longingly in the rearview mirror, the oil rig plume billowing tenderly in response, Our roughnecks' night sweat cooled by the prospect of tomorrow's new depths. It baited as progress, as self-preservation that will not include me, or my pilot, or maybe even you, but whomever has and still sits in the enormous leather chair. Thank you.
I'm going to read two poems. The first is one that I wrote in the subjunctive voice, but a subjunctive that mimics the past tense. In English, we use the subjunctive to think about fantasy, desire, what is not yet real. And often the subjunctive in English is indistinguishable for the past. You are becomes as if you were. And I was thinking about the way in which racism often disguises itself as a kind of nostalgia. There's a similarity in Aryanism, in Gone with the Wind, in Make America Great Again. What is that? What value does that again add? What past are they looking toward? And the poem is actually based on a seventh grade urban legend at my junior high school, which is that Twinkies, the baked goods, are not actually baked. They're just this kind of goo that is exposed to a chemical so that they grow this foamy outer layer. And then they kind of tint the bottoms brown with some stuff to make it look as if they've been baked. This is not actually true, but it seemed worth writing about. Goldacre. As if you were ever wide-eyed enough to believe in urban legends. As if these plot elements weren't the stalest of cliches, the secret lab, the anaerobic chamber, the gloved hand ex machina, the chemical-infused fog. As if every origin story didn't center on the same sweet myth of a lost wholeness. As if such longing would seem more palatable if packaged as nostalgia. As if there had once been a moment of unity, smoothly numinous, pellucid, as if inner and outer were merely phases of the same substance, as if this whiteness had been your original condition. As if it hadn't been what was piped into you, what seeped into each vacant cell, each air hole, each pore, as if you had started out skinless, shameless, blameless, creamy as if whipped, passive as if extruded, quivering with volatility in a metal mold. As if a catalyzing vapor triggered a latent reaction, as if your flesh foamed up, a hydrogenated emulsion consisting mostly of trapped air. As if, though sponge-like, you could remain shelf-stable for decades, part embalming fluid, part rocket fuel, part glue. As if you had been named twin, a word for likeness, or wink, a word for joke, or ink, a word for stain, or key, a word for answer. As if your skin oxidized to its present burnished hue, golden as if homemade. And then this is the poem I wrote for the anthology, and I was one of the people who turned the poem in like 15 minutes before the deadline. it's based on four definitions of the word mine. A guide to usage, mine. A, pronoun, my, belonging to me. How should I define the limits of my concern, the boundary between mine and not mine, the chime of the pronoun like a steel ring cast over what I know, what I name, what I claim, what I own? The whine of the pronoun hones its edges to keenness because there is power in the categorical that prides itself and plumps itself and proliferates until there is no air, room in here for anything but power, till there is no air in here. But there would be no need for air if you could learn to breathe in whatever I breathe out. B, noun one, a pit or tunnel in the earth from which precious stones or ores or coal are taken by digging or by other methods. Because the earth does not gleam with the shine of the noun, to dig into the earth is imperative.
to use my fingers, or else to fashion more rigid, more perjurable fingers that cut or delve or sift or shatter, because we are more evolved than animals, because to mine is not to burrow, because the earth is not for us to live in, because the earth is not precious in itself, the earth is that from which what is precious is taken, what is scraped away or blasted away or melted away from what my steel-tipped fingers can display or sell or burn. C, noun 2, a device intended to explode when stepped upon or touched or when approached by a ship, vehicle, or person. My device redefined by intent, so thin-skinned this earth is untouchable. A sly simulacrum of innocence, concealing an infinity of hair trigger malice, the cry of the noun sealed in a concentric sphere that sheaths its lethal secret in silence. Unapproachable, it sings its unspeakable harvest in this field I have seeded with violence. D, verb, to dig away or otherwise remove the substratum or foundation of. To sap, to ruin by slow degrees or secret means. To dig is to build dark dwellings of negative space, to knit a linked network of nothing. The seams of the seemingly solid unravel, the itch of erosion, the scratch of collapse, each absence the artifact of specific intention. An abscess, a crater, a honeycomb of dead husks. The home of the verb is founded on ruin. The crime of the verb hollows out prisons and graves. The rhyme of the verb tunnels from fissure to fracture, from factory to faction, from fault line to fate. This foundation is equal parts atom and emptiness. This fear invades fractally by rhizome and root. What cement could salvage this crumbling concrete should I pledge my allegiance to unearthing or earth? Thank you.
I'm going to read a handful of short poems and really grateful to be a part of this night. I wanted to start, though, with just this tiny paragraph from the beginning of William Carlos Williams' Introduction to the Wedge, a book he published in 1944. And I have it tacked above my desk, and I think of it sometimes when being a poet might seem insufficient to the darkness that surrounds us and the role of poetry. The war is the first and only thing in the world today. The arts generally are not. Nor is this writing a diversion from that for relief, a turning away. It is the war, or part of it, merely a different sector of the field. Sentences in a synapse field. For I wanted sound to dig into sound, for snow and blood, for wine and mirrors, for electrons and electricity, for debris, for damaged art, our collective fortune, future. For as long as there have been soldiers, there have been poets. For as long as poets, there has been a bridge. For I wanted to hold a room in silence for debris flooding back into a wave. For as long as particles a charge, for it should be incredulity to be alive for these things that can be told until mystery becomes elegy. For it was March going into April, for the day was speaking the day, for what you thought, for what you buried, for who you are. And here's the poem that I was also late in turning in to the Boston Review. The ingenuity of animal survival. Deep in the enzyme is the shape of home. Deep in the code is the architecture to nest. The robin collects mud with its beak, along with twigs and pieces of down and feathers too. The grouse burrows into the subnivian world for heat and shelter. The raven uses branches and breaks them off with its weight and its beak. It papers its nest with bits of fur and debris. The mother goose sheds her chest feathers to line the chamber. Sorrow is long. When will I return to my country? Archaeophonics. I'm just visiting this voice. I'm just visiting the molecular structures that say what I am saying. I am just visiting the world at this moment, and it's on fire. It's always been on fire. I'm saying this, and it's saying me. That's how it works, seesaw-like. The archive in the mouth, and the archive is on fire. That's the story, the sun in the body, and the body in the sun. It was like this, just like this, the world that's coming toward me, and the world around me. Around me are words saying this, saying fire, saying something, or all of it. I said they were short. Strangeness becomes you. The old language is the old language. It don't mean shit. It's not where you begin. It's how you finish. Everyone's got beer muscles when they're young. Try as you must, break as you will. Solo in space, clinging to space. Fuck, the air said, passing a corner, a long ropey snot hitting a gutter. To know something and fail. Why discount it? The onslaught of eyes beneath a fuck you sky. The syntax breaks down its mangled draft and says, one day the poor will have nothing to eat but the rich. I hate that when syntax connects me to the rich.
Hi, I'm Timothy Donnelly, third and final poetry editor of Boston Review. And I'll be reading two poems that appeared in our pages prior to the election. It was important to us when putting together the anthology to think of this as a continuation of work that we'd been doing for some time already, but brought to a higher pitch. And before I read these two poems, I do want to give thanks also to Matt Lord, associate editor of Boston Review, without whom this anthology could certainly not have been possible. The first poem that I'll read is by the poet Solmaz Sharif. Solmaz is, she was born in Istanbul, and she, of Iranian parents who came to the States in the 70s, and they came here to study. And this poem is called Safe House. Its left-hand margin uses a lexicon that's taken from the Dictionary of Military and Associated Terms that was published by the Defense Department. It runs from sanctuary to shortfall. Safe house. Sanctuary where we don't have to sanitize hands or words or knives, don't have to use a scale each morning, worried we take up too much space. I scan my memory of Baba talking on screen, answering a question, how are you? I would ask and ask from behind the camera, his face changing with each repetition as he tried to watch the football game. He doesn't know this is the beginning of my scribing life, repetition and change. A human face at the seaport and a home growing smaller. Let's search my father's profile, mustache, black, and holding back a secret he still hasn't told me. Section of the couch that's fallen a bit from his repeated weight. Sector of the government designed to keep him from flying. He kept our house secure, except from the little bugs that come with dried herbs from Iran. He gives security officers a reason to get off their chairs. My father is not afraid of sedition. He can seize a wild pigeon off a Santa Monica street or watch seizures unfold in his sister's bedroom, the FBI storming through. He said, use wood sticks to hold up your protest signs, then use them in self-defense when the horses come. His eyes sensitive when he passes advice to me, like I'm his sequel, like we're all a serial caught on Iranian satellite TV. When you tell someone off, he calls it servicing. When I stand on his feet, I call it shadowing. He naps in the afternoon and wakes with sheet lines on his face, his hair upright. The sound of shells specify the sound of mussel shells on the lip of the Bosphorus crunching beneath his feet. He's given me shelter and shielding, shown it's better to travel away from the shoal. Let them follow you, he says, from somewhere in Los Angeles, waiting for me. If he feels a shortfall, he doesn't tell me about it. This poem is by one of my favorite poets, Brenda Hillman, who is also a very committed environmentalist. The environment, too, of course, is under increasing threat, all in the name of enterprise. And this poem is called Poem of Hope, Almost at Equinox. Hope, too, seems to be under threat, but I think one of the things we as poets can do is to take what might seem like a fatuous platitude of encouragement, you mustn't lose hope, and turn it into something that is as urgent and complicated and necessary and deep and compelling as it should be. And this poem, again, is called Poem of Hope, Almost at Equinox. Asking the sun to come soon, I still sense inside the glad dimness this love, the aluminum cloud, balance of night that shines in the cedar. Earth's energy struggles with its cloak of worry. Venus drops from Jupiter, its radiance delicate as saliva. From our bed, its bed, their bed, getting up to keep watch under the genderless shadow of events. Violence and the only heart, canceled. In warmer valleys, new little badgers, blind and furred. Regrets to the heronry. The heron cannot see them where they hide. History wakes us to sort it out with the press of great voices, silent now. I fear the bosses will always win. Behind the owl, a broken line of sound, green or baby everything, badgers, herons, the spirits have abandoned me. Let me not abandon myself. Thanks.
Delicate songs I wear on my eyelids. Their smiles have given me freedom, which is a crater I keep falling in.